Hello people, welcome back to my channel. The topic for today's video is structure of a neural unit or a small neuron that we use in our neural networks. So in the last video we saw a gentle introduction regarding what is deep learning and few of the concepts that we'll be using throughout this particular series. So let's start how a particular neuron looks like. So before we start this video, let me remind you that we are not practically mimicking or imitating the real neuron in our human brain. Why? Because we have certain limitations in mimicking that in today's world also, in this present time. So we'll be considering one particular neuron unit. So instead we'll be not saying it as a neuron, but instead we'll consider it as a unit. So say this is how we represent a unit. So we don't call this as neuron since we are not learning any biological activity in this. Just we have certain mathematical computations and let's see how different results are computed. So what you basically have is you have some input that is coming in this direction and you have say some output. So that is evitable for any process. You provide some input and there you have some black box or white box, you get some desired output. Now this particular neuron is internally divided into two portions. So first, on the left hand side you have something called as a linear function, which is nothing but your summation, and then you have something called as a non-linear function, NLF. So here, say for example, we are using a step function. We'll come into later why we cannot use a step function. So essentially, in the input, say we are having some input, say x1 and x2. And with these inputs, we provide some kind of weights. So these weights are essentially called as coefficients, or this represent the strength of your neural connectivity. Means this is the link that is going through this particular neuron. So how much weight does this particular input has, that is represented by the weight which is shown over it. So inside this, since it's a linear function, what output do you get as a result of this is w1 x1 plus w2 x2. So this is nothing but your normal y is equal to mx plus c, that is for linear regression. So since we are not talking about the bias, we'll just come into this intercept a bit later. So what essentially have is in the first part, you have this linear function. So it will do the product of sum of all the weights multiplied by the input vector, and then it will pass on to the non-linear function. Now in the human brain also, we have this left brain and right brain. So that is part for some conceptual and some for logical. So essentially in the real world also, if we have only the conceptual ideas, and if you require some logical functionalities to be implemented in the real world, then it becomes difficult for a human being also. So essentially that is also the case with a neuron also. So it needs to have both the linear function as well as non-linear function. Else if it is only with this left brain or only the linear function, then that particular neuron will collapse. So non-linear function helps any neuron from collapsing. So this non-linear function NLF is also called as sometimes the activation function. So basically whatever it comes from this particular left hand side, it will just activate that according to some predefined function which you put. So there are different kinds of activation functions like sigmoid, you have tanh, you have ReLU, leaky ReLU, and many other. So by this after computation you get this particular output. Now let's talk a bit about this function, that is the step function. So since in we know, like in our gradient descent, we have this particular j which is a function of the weights and the biases. So since we know about this cost function from gradient descent, how it looks basically is something like this. In three dimension you obtain a bowl shaped function. So where on this axis you have this error, you have this b, and you have the weight. So what you do is you basically calculate the gradient and you start from this point to this point, this point to this point, and you converge at this particular step where the error is equal to zero. So this is our major goal whenever we do gradient descent, or this is also implemented in this neural networks. Now our main problem is, if we have a step function, if you just closely observe, it has some breaks or breaking point at this two places. So whenever we take derivative of this, what happens is that our neural network will fall to local minima. So instead, what should be our solution is, we should provide something like that our function should be a smooth function. So for that, what we basically use, or for all of the default neural networks, we use a sigmoid function. So sigmoid function, we have already learned, this is not new for us. So since in logistic regression, we have this logit function, that is nothing but our sigmoid function. So for which, say we have 1 upon 1 plus e raised to minus z. So that is given as the output function for this. So the activation function in most of the cases used as logistic regression, that is for a sigmoid function. So we compute a sigmoid, say our output is represented as z. So it just modifies this in this particular way. So essentially what our curve now just will look like is, so since we had our original function like this, so what is the problem is that if you try to fit a line in this, what it will have is, you can just extend to infinity and positive infinity and negative infinity. So minus and positive infinity. But since you know all these things are used for probability representations, probability can't be put into negative and positive infinity. Instead, it should be confined to some interval between 0 or 1. So it should be a fuzzy kind of thing. So instead, what we do is, we try to squeeze this and say we have a threshold somewhere here, and we try to squeeze this at some particular threshold. So say this is our 0.5, and for all values below this 0.5, we classify it as 0, and for all above, we classify it as 1. So it attains 0 at minus infinity and attains positive 1 at positive infinity. So this is our sigmoid function that we basically use. And further, if we want to take the derivative of this, then this becomes handy, where if we use our step function, then that will fall prey to local minima. Now, since in this case we have considered only two inputs, that's not the case in the real world. So you have the linear function, non-linear function, you have x1, you have x2, you have x3 up till xn. So you can have any number of inputs to this, and accordingly you have weights wn. So despite of providing n number of inputs, your processing of your neuron does not change. So that has no impact. So regardless if it's two inputs or n number of multiple outputs, your neuron would perform the same way how you put your linear function and your non-linear function, whether it's sigmoid or anything else. Now essentially, since we are using this activation function as our sigmoid, since we know these are our inputs and these are the weights provided, that is the connectivity strength to each of these inputs, we can essentially represent our z in this form, that is w1 x1 plus w2 x2 plus up till wn xn. So what our sigmoid function will do is, at the end it will just do a consolidation of all these weight functions, and it will do, or it will transform in this way. So irrespective of you do all of these computations, your final output would be one single value, that is either 0 or either 1, or you can have any number of probability values. Now let us take another scenario. Say you have some inputs x1, x2, x3 and x4. So now since we know what is a neuron, we'll just try to build a neural network. So say we have some three inputs here, and say we have one output. So what do you see basically here? So this part is nothing but your input layer. I'll write it as IL. Then what you have is here, that is a output layer. I'll write it as OL. It gives some output, say Y cap. And what you can see here in this middle portion, this is your hidden layer. So when you construct a neural network, you can have any number of hidden layers. So hidden layer are those layers which are explicit of your input and the output layer. So whatever you subtract from this portion or the whatever is there at the end, you just remove this or you just separate this. Whatever is left inside or between this input and output layers, those constitute your hidden layer. So hidden layers can be any in number. So hidden layer can essentially be called your hyperparameter. So it depends upon your application scenario, how you want to tune your hidden layers or how many connections you want to have or how complicated you want to build your neural network. So what basically happens is that this particular neuron, so these are individual units. So to these individual units, you get input from this to this to this. So with this, what you basically have is you have weights. So this is coming from the first input. So similarly, you have W12, W13. Similarly, with the second input, you have like this. So that is W21, W22, W23. Similarly, you have W31, W32, W33, W41, W42 and W43. So just for only these two connections or for having a network between this input layer and this hidden, you basically have, that is 4 × 3, that is 12 number of weights. So just for only these connections, that is you multiply each of these inputs with the weights, you have 12 number of weights for this particular connection. And when you have this here, you basically apply your sigmoid. So say this is output from the first, so that is sigma z1, this is sigma z2 and sigma z3. And also you have, say, weight something is here, so that is W and W dash and W double prime. So essentially your output function would look like W × σz1 plus W′ × σz2 plus W′′ × σz3. So the resultant of this goes to your sigmoid function, that is 1/(1+e^2) minus this quantity. So that will just squeeze your particular value of all these calculations. So now you can assume like how many computations are there if you put n number of different layers. So assume this is case for convolution neural networks where each of the inputs represent some pixels or some pattern. So then you can have different neural outputs for connectivity. Now since you have only one neuron, this is bound only for binary classification. Why binary classification? Why? Because we are deploying a sigmoid function and it has two values, that is between 0 and 1. So this value, that is sigma z, ranges between 0 and 1. So this is the interval where it will just put the value. So it's like, say, whether I should go outside today or not. So that is again a classification, binary classification, yes or no. So wherever you require yes, no, true, false, 0, 1 kind of stuffs, or if you want to predict that or if you want to model that in a neural network, you basically go with binary classification by using sigmoid function. Else, if you have, say, some image classification, whether it's apple or banana or orange or grapes, some fruits. So that's essentially a multi-class problem. So with multi-class problem, you cannot deploy this particular kind of neural structure since you have only one output neuron here. There you can have different neurons representing each of these different classes. So that's for multi-class problem. And since we have not talked about the bias, so bias will be there for each and every neuron. So since we have 1, 2, 3 and 4 neuron, you will have bias 1, bias 2, bias 3 and bias 4. So with 12 bits, you will have an additional 4, that is, you will have 16 total of quantities that you will be learning. So essentially major goal is when you get the output, whether the classification is wrong or if that prediction is incorrect, you basically just backtrack by using some algorithms called as backpropagation that will be covering down the line. So there you basically learn all this basically weights and you just modify this weight so that you get the correct output. So well, that was all regarding the structure of a neuron in deep learning. So hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you got educated from this video, please do like, share, comment, and if you're new to this channel, please consider subscribing. Thank you very much for watching this video.